Welcome back, everyone, to another episode of the Chamber Podcast. My name is Rob Johnson. So we have an awesome show for you today. I'm really excited about it. It is a remote show, so joining me remotely is Dr. Senya Tomovich. Excited to have Dr. Tomovich on the show today. So we are talking allergies, all things ENT. So first off, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me. Hello, everybody.
I have a lot of questions. There's a lot of different topics we can dive into, obviously. I think the one that I am seeing the most right now is everyone has allergies, especially people that come into the studio. The amount of sniffling edits we've had to do is probably tripled every spring. So before we dive into all that, though, so can you tell me a little bit about kind of what made you want to go into medicine? How did you get to the spot where, you know, you're now in the ENT classification as a physician?
Oh, interesting. So I kind of knew from an early age I wanted to do medicine. My grandmother was actually a doctor. She was a pulmonologist, and she inspired me and then went into medicine. During medical school, I enjoyed a lot of the head and neck anatomy, and so doing ENT seemed to fall in line with my interest, and thankfully I was able to go that route. And so I was actually out in New Jersey practicing, well, doing my residency and practicing, and then I recently came back home here.
And where's your clinic located out of?
So we have several locations. I'm part of the Michigan Otolaryngology Surgery Associates. Here in Brighton, we have a practice at the Genoa Building on Grand River, and then we have several other locations, one in Ypsilanti, one in Chelsea, one in Livonia, and one in Canton.
So what's it been like coming back to Michigan and kind of adjusting and scaling this practice, being both a physician and an entrepreneur? What's that been like?
It's been really interesting. It's been exciting to try to get this area, which is really thriving, kind of plugged into more of what's new in the ENT world, in terms of, as we'll discuss, sleep and sinuses and things of that nature.
Yeah. So let's talk about some of those things that are newer. Let's focus on the sleep area. So sleep apnea, you know, it's a condition that's, you know, growing year over year. I know there's new methodologies for treating sleep apnea or helping combat it. So tell me a little bit about what's new with with sleep and what people need to be paying attention to.
Sure. So yeah, it's a very common problem. Over 10 million people, and the general guidelines for treatment are CPAP. It's a machine. It pushes positive air, pressure air in, and allows the airway to open up, because the problem with sleep apnea is that your airway kind of collapses and the air can't get in. So it's a great device when it works, but it doesn't work for everybody. Unfortunately, people can't tolerate it. It's bulky, it falls off, etc. So about 7 years ago now, there was a product called the Inspire. That's the name of the company, but the idea is that it's called a hypoglossal nerve stimulator. So it basically stimulates the nerve to your tongue under your chin to bring your tongue forward and opens up your airway when you're sleeping. It does this kind of coordinated with your respiration. So it works really well in the right patient. And we've done, myself, over 200 implants. My colleague, Dr. Hoff here, over 200 implants. And I'd say we have about 85 to 90% success rate in our patients.
Wow. How do you mark the success rate of a patient?
That's really a good question. So in sleep apnea, there's kind of a scoring grading system for how bad your sleep apnea is: mild, moderate, and severe. And before, well, I would say in general, the rules are if you can get a patient's sleep apnea number, the severity number, down by 50%, that's considered a success surgically. Ideally, you want to have that down to zero, no apnea. But if you can imagine someone having really severe apnea with a score of 100 going to 50, that's an improvement, but that's still quite a bit of sleep apnea. So with Inspire, I would say we've had all of our patients down to like mild or less sleep apnea. Versus doing some of the other surgeries that we sometimes still need to do, but can be more painful and sometimes not quite as successful.
Okay. So transitioning another part of the head, so sinuses, so allergy season, as I mentioned, it's I see practically everyone has allergies these days, it seems like. So talk to me about what's new in the allergy field. What should people be paying attention to? Is there new medications they ought to be taking? Should they be consulting you if it's at a certain level of severity? Just kind of walk me through all that.
Yeah, good questions too. So yes, allergies are very common, increasing in prevalence for sure. I think, you know, if people pay attention to the pollen counts are going up, particulate matter in general is going up, as we recently know. Again, kind of the gold standard for allergy care and treatment, you should get tested by an allergist to see what you're allergic to, so you know either if you can avoid it, you can use some filters to kind of lessen the load, the burden of allergens. You can take some antihistamines over the counter, Allegra's or Declaritin. Try some nasal sprays, Flonase. But when those don't work or that's not enough, then there's something called immunotherapy, and that's kind of the cure for allergies. Allergies are basically when your system is just too sensitive to some of these pollens and things. So the treatment is something called immunotherapy, where you take an injection, or sometimes there's little drops you can use under your tongue, and they're a low, tiny dose of whatever you're allergic to, and over time, years, it desensitizes your body so you don't have those severe reactions. So those are two options. That's something an allergist would provide, or that sublingual immunotherapy. Some other providers have options for, or allergists. And then, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Oh, well, this is something I'm kind of passionate about is more recently, there have been a lot of these things called biologics, which are usually delivered as shots as well, every 2 to 4 weeks, that can really help reduce that inflammatory pathway that causes the allergies. These are things like Dupixent, Nucala, Xolaire, and they're usually very effective in patients that have some combination of allergies, asthma, and chronic sinusitis. And so those are things that we can prescribe, at least the Dupixent.
Okay. So looking at both of those options, so you had mentioned, you know, whether it's semi-monthly or monthly injections, or you have the drops. So it seems like the injections would be more immediate, whereas the drops, because you're exposing your body to a small amount of those allergens, that would take a lot longer. So I guess on each route, how long would it take for someone to, on average, see success or some efficacy with that type of medicine?
Okay. So with immunotherapy, you're right to say that small dose does take a while. It can take up to 5 years, but then the idea is, 2 to 5 years, depending on the patient. Sure. But it does take a while, but the idea is that's a long-term fix. And when you're done, you're done. Versus the Dupixents and the Nucalas and the other biologics, you should notice a difference pretty much within the first to second dose, which means maybe a month or two. But the problem is you have to be on those kind of indefinitely.
I see.
For now, that's what we think, at least.
Do you ever see people, or is it even advisable to run both concurrently?
It can be. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Because this is in my head, like the way I'm thinking is like, you know, you do the short-term fix and the long-term fix simultaneously, and then hopefully you can jump off of both of them at the same time and have long-term results. So you had mentioned that one thing that I don't know why I don't think about this when I think of ENT doctors is just like on the audio side, the testing noises. You had mentioned that you guys have a pretty big audiology practice. Am I saying that right? Like you have a pretty large landscape for that as well?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So hearing loss is also a pretty common problem due to like noise exposure, due to infections or hereditary reasons. And so depending on how bad the hearing loss is, hearing aids can be very helpful. These are usually for patients that have nerve-related damage. Sometimes when there's other issues, other causes of hearing loss, there may be some surgical options too. So that's where we could evaluate people and determine if that would be an option as well. But hearing aids can help with hearing loss. They can help with buzzing or tinnitus, as we call it. And they, in our older populations, can really help to keep patients plugged into conversations, family events, and potentially slow any kind of cognitive decline or things of that nature.
Okay. Now, so I have two smaller children. So I was always curious, like, what causes ear infections in children? Is allergies kind of a preceding thing for that? Is it completely unrelated? Because I've always seen, you know, children that have high amounts of ear infections typically lead to them getting ear tubes. And just talk to me a little bit about that.
Yeah. So it's really their anatomy that causes it. The way that we usually equalize and allow air to get into the ear and fluid out of the ear is through something called the eustachian tube, which is a tube that's in the back of our nose and it connects to our ear. So if you like think about flying and you try to pop your ears, then that would basically go through your eustachian tube. In children, their eustachian tube is more horizontal versus in adults, it's a little bit more vertical. And the vertical nature of it allows fluids to drain and also reduces the chances of things backing up from the nose into the ears. So it's really that kind of anatomy, the more horizontal tubes that eventually descend. And that's why as adults, we don't tend to get as many ear infections.
Okay. Do you see children struggling with allergies at the same rate as adults, or is it normally something that's more prevalent in adults?
I would say probably a little more prevalent in adults, but certainly there are plenty of children that have it. And, you know, it can vary from food allergies or really environmental allergies. I think especially that seems to be getting a little bit more prevalent. That's just anecdotally.
Okay. So what are some other things that you do at your practice that you want listeners to be aware of and know about? Because I know this is, at least in my mind, and please correct me if I'm wrong, this seems to be one of those things that is extremely important for people to focus on. Allergies, you know, the inflammation that takes place inside of your head. But people seem to just table that and not take care of it as much as they might take care of some other medical ailment.
Sure. So I think we've covered a lot of things in terms of hearing loss, sinuses, sleep apnea. Other things that we see maybe more commonly are nosebleeds. People may not necessarily recognize that it's a problem until they've been to the ER and had packed their nose, and that's, you know, really uncomfortable. But sometimes there are things we can do in the office that can help control the nosebleeds. Then other things, you know, we're always screening for any type of head and neck cancers, especially in the population of patients that smoke. But also it's been more common now, these HPV-related cancers of the tonsils and the back of the tongue. So anyone that comes in with any persistent pain, sometimes it can be referred to the ear even, that can be actually from the tonsils or the back of the tongue. Any trouble swallowing, any voice changes, those are all within our realm and things that we can evaluate in the office.
Okay, excellent. So two final questions for you. One, what is your absolute favorite thing about being a physician? Then I'll get to question number two.
I think really establishing the caring relationships with patients, having patients come back and say like, oh, I'm better. Like, that's the best appointment, obviously for them, but also for me, knowing that the patient is better and that I helped them get there.
That's awesome. And the second question is, what's one of your favorite hobbies that you do when you're not helping people with this, these litany of ailments that they come see you for? What's one thing you do outside work?
I enjoy playing with my kids, and recently they've really gotten into soccer, so we play a lot of soccer. I even coached my kids' soccer team. That was a lot of fun.
That's awesome. That's really cool. Yeah. Excellent. Well, I really appreciate your time, and I'll make sure for the listeners that all of the information for you and the clinic is in the show notes for the podcast. So if you want to know more, if you're looking for a new doctor in the ENT realm, you can find all of our guests' information in the show notes. So thank you so much for taking the time to meet with me today.
Thank you too. Appreciate it. Have a good one.
Thanks. All right, everyone, that's going to wrap up this week's episode of the Chamber Podcast. I appreciate all of you watching. We'll be back again next week with a brand new episode. Take care.